Let's give a round of applause for our next speaker, Dr. Jasper to Groot.
Today, I will be talking about a millennia-old myth and bust it. But first, let's take the time machine back to ancient Greece, the Acropolis, the high city, home to great thinkers and bad smellers. Had bathing been invented yet? And one of these particular great thinkers was Aristotle. And he bullied our sense of smell, which is also called olfaction. He called it vulgar and inferior. Perhaps it was useful for ground-dwelling animals, but humans most certainly stood above it all, literally and figuratively. And unfortunately, not much improved for many centuries, where generations of philosophers joined in bashing ceremonially our nose. And these included the likes of Kant, Schopenhauer, and beyond. And even a notable scientist, Paul Broca, he fueled the tiny smeller myth. He called us non-smellers, not by doing any sensory testing, but he actually compared the size of our brain that processes smells and compared that to the size of our brain involved in rational thinking. And then he compared that to other animals, for instance, mice and rats. And Broca's rational thinking was that humans have the enlarged frontal lobes, which basically give us the power to resist the old odor impulses with our unique rationality. And little did he know, but still his ideas echoed around for many centuries. These were really the dark ages for the sense of smell. And these continued also a century later, because then we had psychoanalyst Sigmund Freud, and he called the human sense of smell uncivilized and yesterday's news. Freud himself was a frequent sniffer of cocaine, that is. And that's not particularly good for your sense of smell. So actually, it eradicated the sense of smell. So should we really trust his judgment here? And still, his ideas were parroted by many others. And it is only ironic that Dr. Unconscious missed out on the great unconscious potential that smells have on our social lives. And talking about the unconscious, someone just passed out here. This is a painting by Rembrandt. Here he pictured the sense of smell. This is the allegory of smell. And what we see here is an unconscious patient being revived by smelling salts. But what Rembrandt did not know is that smelling salts do not affect the sense of smell. They affect the sense of touch, the trigeminal nerve in our nose. This was only discovered later by scientific findings. So you can have great thinkers on the one hand, great painters, but sometimes it takes just ordinary scientists to find out what our nose can really do and how it works. So let's compare ourselves to dogs. Dogs are far better smellers, right? They can track a scent through a field. This is probably something that we can do. But a study has shown recently that humans are actually also capable of following a scent trail through a field. And the scent that they had to follow was chocolate essential oil. So who wouldn't want to follow that? And there's more, because humans are capable of detecting some odorants at the level of just 3 little droplets in an Olympic-sized swimming pool. So for instance, if you have the odor molecule ethyl mercaptan and you have 3 droplets of that and you put it in one swimming pool and not in the other, then your nose can sense what the smelly pool is and you will probably not swim in it because ethyl mercaptan is added to natural gas to make it smell like gas. Because natural gas is odorless and when there is a leak, we want to detect it. And that's why we add this molecule to which our nose is very sensitive so that it can warn us. And how come that we have these skills, but we think we're really poor when it comes to our sense of smell? This is easy to explain because we lack the language for smell. We find it difficult to find words for the smells that we experience, at least in the Western world, because there's also a community of hunter-gatherers in Malaysia, and they can name smells as easy as they can name colors. But to most of us, naming odorants is really difficult. They operate below the surface, so to say, and they affect brain regions that are evolutionary ancient, brain regions that we share with other mammals and also other animals, reptiles, for instance. And these brain areas, they process emotions and survival instincts. So, what can our sense of smell do? So our sense of smell serves actually various functions. But what is our nose good for? Why should we like our nose? Can anyone think of a function? Just please pause for yourself and think. Probably your stomachs are all rumbling because of the food, and I also kind of quickly primed you with this. So judging whether food is edible is a primary function of our nose. So if something smells really good, it's typically nutritious and you want to approach it. If something smells bad, it's typically rotten and you want to avoid it. So that's simple. And there's also another function that our nose has. So it warns us against smells that can potentially harm us. So gas-like smells or smoke. And our nose is quick to pick up these in small quantities and then make us move away from that source. But there is actually more to it. There are two more functions, and those are typically only realized when you lose your sense of smell. And this occurred quite frequently with the recent COVID-19 pandemic. So I'm just curious, whom of you lost the sense of smell due to COVID, at least temporarily? Please raise hands. Yeah, that's actually quite a number of people. So it's only often then that you realize how important it is to you. And some people lose it for good. And then typically you see symptoms like depression and also a lower quality of life. You can no longer smell the forest. You can no longer smell nature, the sea, sunscreen, books, the spring. And this really affects you emotionally. And also you can no longer smell, if you have one, a partner or perhaps children. And this is also another function that has been neglected, and you typically only realize when you lose your sense of smell, and this is social communication. And this fascinates many, that somehow we can subtly influence other people, their social behavior, by means of their smell. Even the prestigious journal Science has highlighted the importance of smell research by listing as one of the most important questions to answer out there to date. Do humans use pheromones? And I'm just wondering, whom of you has an idea what a pheromone means? Please raise your hand and spread your pheromones. Not that many people, actually. And that's actually quite challenging, because that's often the first challenge. What is a pheromone? And when we have to think about it, if we have a certain concept about this, then typically one thing comes to mind first. That's probably sex, right? So initially, pheromones have been identified based on the sex behavior in moths. So you had one moth giving off a molecule, the female moth, and the man would just follow that in hot pursuit. Even against the strong winds, it would just go into that direction. But as it has been shown, even for these moths, their behavior is often context dependent. So it's not that simple that a single molecule can elicit innate behavior in a conspecific, what the original definition of a pheromone was. And rather than focusing on single molecules, because humans emit hundreds of molecules, a whole cocktail of it, and rather than focusing on nature nurture, it's much more fruitful to actually focus on the skill of communication via smell, and also what kind of states and traits can we emit to another person, and what can they pick up? So there has to be some kind of consistency in the chemical form in order to be able to get information out of it. So there is actually a range of states and traits that we can get from another person's odor. For instance, identity. Every person has a unique smell, so every person is unique. Except the exceptions, of course, which in this case are real exceptions, monozygotic twins. They smell exactly the same. Even trained sniffer dogs cannot tell them apart. So there's a genetic component to your body odor. What you can also do is, for instance, smell disease. If you get sick, your body odor changes and other people can pick up on that and perhaps maintain their distance. Or if you're more sociable, maybe help them. And there's another thing, namely related to old age, because I don't know if you have the same impression of it, but old age also has a smell. It has a sort of waxy smell to old age people. And this also has been identified with a chemical analysis. And last but not least, we can sense emotions. For instance, happiness, anger, and fear. And on fear, I focused most. So what I did is I developed psychological experiments to basically see if there would be something like social communication going from a sender to a receiver. And first of all, when I started, this was about 2011, I was a student, and I thought, yeah, probably this is a myth that humans can communicate their emotions by means of their odor. So let's try and see, but probably it doesn't work. And then I did tons of experiments, and I was really astounded by the findings. And for instance, here, there were these experiments that I did that I split into two stages. So first, you had the senders, so you had to collect their body odor, and then you had another group of participants called, they were the victims, they were called the receivers, and they had to be exposed to the body odor. So in the first stage, we would induce a state of fear in senders. And we did this by using horror videos. So these were actually quite scary, so watch them myself and I can attest to it. But also we just measured heart rate, breathing rate, and we saw that this had the proper effect of activating these fear sweat glands. So we induced fear by showing these horror videos, and then the same participants donated their body odor whilst they were just feeling pleasant and neutral, and they're watching a wildlife documentary, and they were in a warm room. So unlike this room, which is very cold, but warm, so they could actually sweat a little bit. So this served as a control condition. And then in the next stage, we exposed another group of people to these body odors, and they didn't know. So here you have a really cool device, which is called an olfactometer, and this can blow air over vials, little pots that were containing the samples, and unbeknownst to the participants, these mad scientists like me were presenting the body odors. And they weren't knowing what was going on. And we measured their emotions. And one way to measure emotions is to apply electrodes to the face. So for instance, you place them here and here, and then you can measure facial expressions. And for instance, we could measure if a receiver would take over a fearful state that the sender had initially experienced. So to see if there would be some kind of contagion of the emotion going on. And you may think, well, hold on, people are smelling sweat, right? So that must be very disgusting. And if you're disgusted, you assume an expression like this, you close off your eyes and nose, you don't want to take in the sensory information. You literally close off the senses. But in this case, what we found is that people exposed to the fear odor actually assumed a fearful facial expression. So they opened their eyes, they increased their visual field size, they literally opened their nose as to better be able to detect threats. So this is a very adaptive mechanism. And here with this face, this was in another experiment in which we presented the fear odor while people were judging faces morphed between disgust and fear. And their task was to decide, when do you see a fearful face? And when they were presented with the fear odor, they were actually quicker to see fear in this face, which was actually a morph between two emotions. So the fear odor does not only change your expression, but it also biases your perception. And now I would like to go to this one, because here the race is really on to detect the molecules that underlie the smell of fear. And actually I did a chemical analysis, and now I have a grocery list of about 6-7 compounds that probably make up this fear odor. And I want to recreate it by just putting the molecules back together. And I even saw that once on my research website that the US Army looked at it. So I don't know if they were planning to make a smell of fear bomb or whatever, but I must admit I just have benevolent intentions when doing this kind of research. At least I hope you trust me in that. But yeah, l- let's go back to the beginning, because I hope you have learned a little bit, and at least when we go back to the past, to these ancient thinkers, I hope that you now see that in the light of scientific evidence, actually the ghosts from the past, they should no longer haunt us, because we have some excellent smell skills. And countering these thoughts that the great thinkers had, and countering all fiction, humans have excellent olfaction. And also, when going back to the beginning, that is, this morning I was talking to my son, he's 6 years old, and was telling him I'm going to have a talk, and he said, yeah, what was it about? What is it going to be about? And I said, yeah, about my research. So I think it's really cool. And what's the research about? I said, smell. And he said, yeah, oh, so you're going to talk about farts. The real sarcastic look. I said, but I hope what you've learned from this talk, actually, that our sense of smell is much more, has much more functions than just picking up bad smells. That we can really appreciate our food through our nose, like with the small bites that we had and the buffet that is coming up. That we can cherish, that we can move away from bad smells, and also that we appreciate the environment, that we smell the spring that is coming up, and also that we can smell our loved ones. So let's get rid of deodorant, let's get rid of perfume, let's just smell people the way they are, because that's the best indicator for relationship quality, the way you evaluate your smell. Yeah, I see it's still a bit of a taboo, but we will get there just in a few years. So thanks for your attention, and have a good night.